one terrible pilot.
How was the war on terror won?
America was targeted for attack.
Investigate this act of war. Before these attacks on our freedom.
One terrible pilot. Hello, I'm Barry Zwicker, journalist and media critic. Welcome to The Great Conspiracy, the 9/11 news special you never saw. On this program, we ask questions the 9/11 Commission and the media never asked. We introduce experts you've never seen before and provide background you never get. We recommend books, magazines, videos, and DVDs you've probably never heard of. And websites the media keep under wraps. We avoid thought stoppers such as anti-American and conspiracy theorists and that new word believed to be linked to Al-Qaeda. U.S. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt declared, "The greatest thing we have to fear is fear itself." And indeed, fear may well be the greatest single human motivator. It can serve us and it can save us. But ill-founded fear, that's another story. For instance, before we commit to a war based on a threat we're told to fear, before we commit our children's blood and billions of dollars to that war, we'd better be sure the threat is real, that a clear and present danger exists. Because war itself is to be feared. U.S. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt fought fear. Today's leaders traffic in it, chiefly the fear of terrorism. That's it. Not global warming, not the end of oil, not domestic and worldwide injustice, not rampant militarism, not war itself, or even war without end. Just terrorism. The words are hypnotically repeated. Terrorism, terrorist, terrorist threat, and of course, believed to be linked to Al-Qaeda. These words appear in millions of newspaper and magazine headlines and are embedded by the billions in stories. But it's the so-called war on terrorism that's in our faces practically 24/7 as the inescapable focus of our existence and the justification for great sacrifice.
One day, our grandchildren will look back on this time and ask, "How was the war on terror won?" And we will tell them about the brave men and women who gave their lives so that we could live in freedom.
Some would have it that our support for this new quasi-religion, the so-called war on terrorism, is the measure of our commitment to country and civilization. This program explores interwoven fictions that make up the fabric of the so-called war on terrorism. It explores the promiscuous issuing of terror alerts. It explores the biggest secret and dirtiest deception of all. Bloody terrorist events carried out not by foreign, but by our governments, to trick the public into supporting war and police state agendas. We explore in particular the radioactive core of today's terrorist hysteria, namely the official story of 9/11, the overarching fiction and crime and cover-up of our time. Before you see this program, or after you do, there may well be another state-sponsored dirty deception. If there is, and if the information in this program helps you to see it for what it is, it will have been worthwhile. The sacred text at the heart of the so-called war on terrorism is the official narrative of what happened on September 11th, 2001, namely that the whole of U.S. intelligence, civil aviation, military, and the political apparatus is caught completely off guard by one evil man and his small network of co-conspirators.
America was targeted for attack because we're the brightest beacon for freedom and opportunity in the world, and no one will keep that light from shining.
That provides ready-made, easy-to-hate villains and their motives. They hate our freedoms, George Bush repeats over and over. But the official story just doesn't make sense, as we will show. It's exploited as planned by its creators, the government. But final responsibility for the unbelievable story living on to the extent it does in the public mind lies with the vast majority of my colleagues in the mainstream media. If they ever start to do their job properly and examine it skeptically, the official story will crumble into dust finer than that of the Twin Towers. Now, absolutely no one disagrees that 9/11 was a conspiracy. Conspiracy is at the heart of the official story, after all. A conspiracy perpetrated, allegedly, by Osama bin Laden. But what if the conspiracy were hatched not in a cave in Afghanistan, but in Washington, D.C., at the highest levels of the U.S. government? What if the public found out the official story is a big lie? How might that change plans for endless war? There are other paths to true security and lasting peace. The first step on those paths is to expose the official 9/11 story for what it is, a contrived fiction, and then to demand a true accounting of what happened on 9/11 and who was behind the events of that day. Terrorism has been with us for a long time. It tends to be the last resort of the powerless, suffering under acute injustice. And as such, one person's terrorist is seen by another as a freedom fighter. This is what Noam Chomsky calls retail terrorism, that carried out by angry or paid individuals. But then there's wholesale terrorism, that carried out by states. Robert Jensen writes in the Houston Chronicle, "For more than five decades, throughout the Third World, the United States has deliberately targeted civilians or engaged in violence so indiscriminate that there is no other way to understand it except as terrorism. And it has supported similar acts of terrorism by client states." He could have reached back further. In his new book, The American Empire and the Fourth World, Anthony J. Hall, according to one reviewer, connects the unspeakable crimes visited upon indigenous people since the conquest by Columbus in 1492 to today's so-called war on terror. According to Hall himself, the imagery of terrorism has replaced that of savagery and then communism as the main explanatory catch-all to describe the real, illusory, or manufactured enemies of the American way of life. So, on one side, ours, the use of terror either is not admitted or is simply defined as not terror. And the other side's terror is defined as the only kind of terror. Terror then needs to be put into perspective. Perspective, writes Lawrence Martin, former Washington correspondent for the Globe and Mail, is a ghost in American journalism. Last year, acts of terrorism killed 300 to 400 people, ranking it so far down the list of dangers that it is barely visible. He might have added that 300 is the number of Americans struck by lightning each year. Another note about appearance and reality. The vast majority of people arrested as terrorism suspects are released without charges being laid. It's the arrest stories with those Arab names and pictures that remain in the public mind as reality. Isn't there a pattern of state-sponsored, media-abetted deception here? But the dirtiest secret about terrorism is also by far the largest. Many spectacular acts of terrorism are fearsome fakeries carried out by cabals within governments, and I mean our own governments. The gold standard is the attack on one's own country to mobilize public opinion for power, political gain, and profit. The Nazis masterminded the torching of the Reichstag, the German parliament buildings, on February the 27th, 1933, 1 week before a national election. That they did so is historical fact, portrayed best in William L. Shirer's masterpiece, The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. Within hours, Hitler and his henchmen designate the communists as the villains and label them terrorists. The government promises proof, but never provides it. The communists did not do it. A single communist was the patsy. The big lie of who torched the Reichstag is used by Hitler to sow fear. He bullies the German president to sign a decree suspending seven main articles of the German Constitution. The claim is that the fatherland, think homeland, is under threat. Ensuing arrests and murders of communists and socialists terrorize anti-Hitler dissent. In the ensuing election, Hitler does not get the majority he needs to rule. But soon after, he essentially seizes power. He then is free to launch preemptive strikes against other countries and wage a world war sold as patriotic. The ultimate result for Germans is calamitous. 600,000 civilians dead, 7.5 million homeless, their country broke and in ruins. The Reichstag fire was a major turning point. Within hours of the planes crashing into the World Trade Center, the Bush White House designates the alleged villains. Within 30 days, the U.S. Constitution and the civil liberties of Americans are weakened by near unanimous passage of the Patriot Act. A war on terror is announced. Within months, preemptive strikes are launched against Afghanistan and Iraq, though no evidence is produced that Iraq took part in 9/11. Dissent in the USA is under fire, even as millions in the USA and worldwide oppose the Iraq war. The White House announces that the war on terror, in effect, world war, may never end. At least 1,000 Americans are soon to die in Iraq alone. Expenditures mount into the trillions. The so-called war on terrorism justifies the mounting deaths of U.S. soldiers and civilians in Iraq and elsewhere, justifies the little publicized construction of giant new U.S. military bases overseas, and is the basis for the doctrine of preemptive war, contrary to international law and basic morality. It's responsible for grotesquely ballooning deficits to pay for all this, debts being passed on to coming generations, and plans for even more expenditures on terror-fighting bureaucracies. The so-called war on terror is cited as the ultimate basis for sharp increases in domestic spying and reduction in freedoms and civil liberties at home and attempts to criminalize dissent. All this because the official authorized truth is that foreign terrorists attacked the USA on 9/11. As we tape this in the summer of 2004, fear grows as authorities and pundits predict more terrorist events on the scale of 9/11 or greater. The I word, inevitable, is increasingly used. The designated scapegoats of 9/11 gained nothing positive from it. On the other hand, even the hardliners in Washington themselves agree 9/11 boosted their agenda. Who benefits from more of the same? The fear campaign, always resting on the official 9/11 story, looks deliberate. Again, what if the official story of 9/11 is a big lie? You probably don't know, if you're trapped inside the cocoon spun by the North American media industry, that there is in fact widespread skepticism about who was behind 9/11. 30% of Germans, according to reliable polls, think the U.S. government had a hand in it. They remember that big Reichstag deception. This poll done in Canada in May 2004 showed 63% of Canadians think individuals within the U.S. government, including the White House, had prior knowledge of the plans for the events of September 11th and failed to take appropriate action to stop them. In this program, we present some of the accumulating evidence indicating that lying behind the great deception of 9/11 is the great conspiracy of 9/11. But first, more historical context. When we come back, three true stories of fake attacks on America.
Let's find out about despotism. This man makes it his job to study these things.
Well, for one thing, avoid the comfortable idea that the mere form of government can of itself safeguard a nation against despotism.
Welcome back to The Great Conspiracy, the 9/11 news special you never saw. If 9/11 is a big lie, a fake attack, an inside job, is it unique? No, quite the reverse. Most war-triggering incidents are great deceptions. The Mexican-American War, the Spanish-American War, the attack on Pearl Harbor, all involved secretly contrived attacks on Americans planned or encouraged by American presidents. The Vietnam War and Desert Storm in 1991 also were triggered by deceptions involving U.S. presidents. If 9/11 is not such a deception, it's an exception to the rule. Most people want peace most of the time. That's a problem for rulers bent on war. History teaches that rulers arranging for their country to be attacked, or appear to be attacked, is the fastest method for these rulers to get their way when they want war. Consider only three cases, starting with this book, Body of Secrets. Author James Bamford is a former Washington investigative producer for ABC's World News Tonight with Peter Jennings. I learned of this book on ABC's website. Bamford's information comes from interviews with, for instance, the former dean of the U.S. intelligence community, and from government documents. It takes 80 pages to list Bamford's more than 600 information sources. Here's the story. It's 1962. John F. Kennedy is U.S. president, Robert McNamara is Secretary of Defense, and Admiral Lyman Lemnitzer heads the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff. The CIA fails in its illegal Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba. JFK decides, Bamford writes, to back away from military solutions to the Cuban problem. But Lemnitzer, the CIA, and others at the top remain obsessed with Cuba. Writes Bamford, as the Kennedy brothers appeared to suddenly go soft on Cuba, Lemnitzer could see his opportunity to invade quickly slipping away. Attempts to provoke the Cuban public to revolt seemed dead. Lemnitzer and the other chiefs knew there was only one option left that would ensure their war. They would have to trick the American public and world opinion. Lemnitzer comes up with Operation Northwoods. We could blow up a U.S. ship in Guantanamo Bay and blame Cuba. Casualty lists in U.S. newspapers would cause a helpful wave of national indignation. We could develop a communist Cuban terror campaign in the Miami area, in other Florida cities, and even in Washington. An elaborate variation. Create an exact duplicate for a civil registered aircraft. At a designated time, the duplicate would be loaded with selected passengers, all boarded under carefully prepared aliases. The actual registered aircraft would be converted to a drone, a remotely controlled unmanned aircraft. The destruction of that aircraft will be triggered by radio signal. The Cubans would be blamed.